The club in the small village of Lanchan, Ivano-Frankivsk region, looks almost like a resort. Today, the villagers are celebrating their annual village holiday. Most of these boys and girls are underage, but they know how to have fun. They are kissing passionately and drinking alcohol. They have enough money to make their adult wishes come true. Every month, they receive money from abroad. Every other child's mother is earning money abroad. That's why the party will continue all night long. Nobody's going to tell these children to come home. Naples is a city that never sleeps. Along these streets, Ukrainian Tetyana Roshko is going to work.
I used to work as a primary school teacher. I'm the mother of three children. I've been working in Italy for the past 12 years.
Just like thousands of other Ukrainians earning money abroad, Tetyana originally came here on a tourist visa.
I was officially on a tourist trip to Austria. We were provided with an official program and had to study our route carefully in order to remember all the places of interest we were supposed to be visiting. We had to be ready to talk about our trip if we were asked. Everyone received the same instructions. The bus stopped near the forest and we threw all our personal documents away. We had no food with us, as officially we were just tourists. Suddenly, close to a roadside cafe, a man with a machine gun entered the bus. He was Ukrainian. He told us we each had to give him $100. He was swearing and said we should earn this money back. I had no money at all. There were old ladies in the bus, women with children. All of us were very scared. I had never seen a machine gun before. There were men on the bus, but they did not say a word. One of the women who had worked in Italy before advised us to comply. She said, "Girls, if you don't give them the money, they will pull you off the bus, and nobody knows what will happen to you then."
It is impossible to give an exact figure for the number of Ukrainian women who are working in Italy. But in Ukrainian villages like this one, there are hundreds of children growing up without their mothers. Many call them social orphans. One of them is 12-year-old Ruslan. His mother works as a cleaner in Italy.
I've been living without my mother since I was 2 years old. I am not lonely now, but I used to miss my mum badly when I was in kindergarten. I got used to life without my mother. We talk via Skype. Hello, give me one loaf of bread, please.
The boy has never seen his father. His grandmother, Miroslava Kirillovna, is bringing him up.
People were going to Italy from almost every house. Many of our neighbors went there, and my daughter also decided to go. It was very difficult because her child was left behind. At first, he did not pay much attention to the fact that he was alone. He didn't notice that his mother was not around. Later, when he went to school, he often cried in the evening. He wanted his mother to be with him.
Mommy.
This is the photo of his mother in Italy.
Ruslan's mother, Halina, lives 2,000 kilometers away from Girona. She's in Naples, one of the most dangerous cities in Italy. But Halina is not afraid of walking along the streets in the evening. She's used to it. The only thing which makes her heart sink is the sound of children laughing.
This is the center of Naples. It's the historic district. Lots of Ukrainians live here. Each morning I go to work, and at 8 o'clock in the evening I return home.
In the morning she goes to one job, and then in the afternoon she goes to another family, and she works all day long.
Though Ruslan has memorized his mother's work schedule, whenever he has a spare moment, he goes to the village library to call his mother via Skype on the off chance that she is online. There are almost no modern roads in Girona, but fortunately, people have access to high-speed internet. Even in small and isolated villages like this, internet access is provided to allow children to see their mothers and talk to them.
Good day. Можно с мамой связаться по Skype? Можно, Руслан.
Ruslan's mother Halina is going home from work. She buys cheap food for supper. Ukrainian women working abroad generally keep their living expenses to a minimum. They even economize on food. They try not to spend money on themselves and send every penny home. The best option is to live in the employer's house. This allows them to avoid food and accommodation costs. These women avoid questions about their salary. They are afraid to reveal any details, especially after the recently adopted Ukrainian law, which states that 15% of money transferred to relatives should be paid into the state pension fund. This law has angered those who have had to go abroad to save their families from poverty. In another part of Naples, in a fashionable district, Tatiana is going to her second job. All day long, she was babysitting for an Italian family, and now she is beginning her night shift as a nurse, taking care of this old and helpless senior.
If you work for a family, you're busy all day long doing various chores. If you're taking care of the elderly people, you need more psychological strength. You have to be there and listen to them. They may even cry.
This man is a famous Italian professor. He is 90 years old, and he needs care around the clock.
In Ukraine, people tell jokes about women who entertain senior citizens in Italy. Everybody's laughing, but I sometimes want to cry.
Tatiana takes care of this senior citizen from evening till morning, earning 250 euros per month. She accepted this job in order to be able to pay her rent. Many Ukrainian women in Italy do such work 24 hours a day. Those who agree to live in this type of prison can earn up to 1,000 euros per month.
You have to be here from morning till night. You can't miss work or stay at home. I have never taken a single day off since I started working here. Once I felt bad, but I took some pills and went to work. Nobody cares whether you're ill or not. Your employers can easily hire another person instead of you. So you have to say, yes, senora, yes, of course. You have to please them. You're just like a slave. Your employers smile at you as though everything is okay, but everything is not okay.
Having had no luck trying to talk to his mother via Skype, Ruslan is going back home. This bicycle was sent to him by his mother from Italy, together with the usual monthly sum of money. Ruslan's granny is already waiting for him to come for dinner.
I always tell him, your mother loves you and she will come back to you. She will earn some money so you will be able to study. There are only two of us here. He supports me and I support him. Come in, little man. Halina decided to go to Italy because she could not find work here. She had to do it in order to bring up her child and provide him with all the essentials. So we made a deal. She earns for the family while I bring up Ruslan. Have your dinner.
Yeah.
This is our Halina. Thanks to her, we have everything. She helps her sister and brother too. We renovated this flat, bought a new fridge and furniture. There was one big room here before. We partitioned it and made a bedroom, a kitchen, and a bathroom instead.
Halina herself lives in much more modest conditions in Naples. She rents a room in a central but poor and rather rough neighborhood, populated by labor migrants from different countries and continents. The rent is lower in this part of Naples. A one-room apartment costs around 300 euros per month. This tower block resembles a dormitory, but Halina calls it a palazzo in Italian. She considers herself lucky to have an apartment here.
It's not easy to find an apartment here in Naples. First of all, you should try to find Ukrainians that you can be neighbors or roommates with, so that you can come home after work and relax in peace. It can be difficult to make friends with strangers, especially in these circumstances.
Привіт, Лінуль. Я вже з роботи.
Я раніше прийшла, зберігаю, знімаю, бо постирала, така жара, так не можу.
Жарко сьогодні, дуже жарко. Збирай бельо, то зараз я буду ще розвішувати машинку свою. Коли я зайшла перший раз до Ліни в квартиру,
when I came to Lena's apartment for the first time, I really liked it. I have been living here for 3 years. There are lots of Ukrainians in this neighborhood. Our good friends live over there, a husband and a wife. They have seasonal employment. Every summer they go to a resort to work in a restaurant. They usually come back in November. One more couple lives over there, Oleg, his wife, and their little son Arthur. There are also lots of Ukrainians on the sixth floor. Misha, as far as I know, is from Ternopil. Katya lives on the second floor with the little kid. Her husband works day and night. She leaves their child in kindergarten and goes to work too.
Тоже треба посилку завтра тоже послати.
Малі посилаєш?
Ну так, там вже все приготувала, купила все, що треба, бо вона хоче трошки, щоб мама там макаронів, помідорів.
Кіндера.
Кіндера. Бо привикла тут до цієї їди, ти хоче тепер, щоб на Україні трошки поїсти макаронів.
Короче, пішла.
Having spent 10 years in Italy, Halina has developed muscles that would make an athlete jealous. Her figure is the result of hard physical work. She cleans 2 apartments per day.
Іноді буває так, що, Господи, як я вже устала.
Sometimes I think, oh my God, I'm so tired. I wish it were possible to live like this in Ukraine, to go to an agency or a factory and find a decent job in order to earn enough money to pay the rent and bring up my child.
Платити так же за квартиру, комунальні услуги і ростити свою дитину. І навчати її далі.
But at the moment, this isn't possible in Ukraine.
Прийти, щоб для тебе все було.
Мені зараз страшно вертатися в Данцю.
I'm afraid of what would happen if I went home. It was very difficult to survive on just my mother's pension.
Це було дуже тяжко.
Я вона, що мені все щось передає, солодке, таке вона мені...
Mom sends me presents all the time. She promised to buy me a guitar. She sent me rollerblades. I wish my mother would buy me a car. I'm even saving my own money to buy it. Each month I put aside 50 or 100 hryvnia.
Що ти там щось малому купляла? Кросовки купила?
Кросовки купила, як завжди.
Ще що купила?
Шортики, футболочки 3.
Ну, скучаєш сильно за ним?
Звичайно. І каже по комп'ютері, мама, я хочу тебе вже бачити. А бабуся каже, та ти маму бачиш кожен день. А він каже, ну та я маму бачу, але обняти то я не можу.
Боже, будемо роботи, Галю, поки своя мрія не збудеться, щоб квартиру купити, один прекрасний
дітей
день.
Дітей забезпечити, ну, щоб діти вивчилися.
І приїхати на Україну.
Поки сили є, а потім вернемося на Україну. Я не їздила додому, то 10 днів була і навіть не поняла, що була. Приїхала і така ностальгія.
У мене річка Дністер, річка Свіча, рядом ліс, природа. Вечором вийдеш, та ти що, Лена?
А у нас теж там біля церкви ріка, Рось протікає, теж багато все, санаторій пооткривалось, таке все теж.
Даже непривично, вечором вийдеш, посидиш на лавочці, тишина така.
Боже, Лія, зайчику, а ти їдеш чи ні?
А вона відчує,
так. Боже, а я їду. І ти їдеш, і я їду.
Боже, ти що?
These women are happy today. They're going to Ukraine on vacation.
We are from Ternopil region. We only have one problem. We left our families behind and went to earn money for them. Ukraine does not provide us with anything.
This place looks like an ordinary Ukrainian bus station. It is hard to believe that the most gorgeous amphitheater in the world, the Colosseum, is just 100 meters away. This is the heart of the Italian capital, the Piramide metro station. Every Sunday, some 50 buses from Ukraine come here. A trip to Ukraine costs 100 euros. There are not many passengers, but a lot of luggage. People mainly use these buses to send parcels with food and clothes for their families.
It weighs 5 kilograms. These buses are like homing pigeons. At the beginning, they used to be the only means of communication. There was a time when there was no cell phones, and we were sending parcels and letters to our families by these buses, and we received our answers in the same way.
Olhan doesn't mention the most important thing about these buses. Women also use them to send money. Passing on cash via the driver used to be much more popular than bank transfers. After the enactment of the Ukrainian pension fund law, which slapped a tax on their hard-earned money, economic migrants are more likely to switch back to hand-to-hand transfers. These buses resemble cash-in-transit vehicles. Even if they're not carrying money, they're transporting the people who give it to their families. For a solid 15 years, Zina has been sending all the money she earns to Ukraine.
Я змирилася з тим, що мушу виконувати то. І чесно тягну той
мій. I accept my situation and am ready to accept my fate. I do it for my children and my husband. I will be happy as long as they are happy. I'm speaking now on behalf of all of us. We all have the same dreams and wishes. I dream of coming home one day and bringing all the family together to sing the Ukrainian national anthem. I believe that Ukrainians will one day have everything we need to live a normal, civilized life. We deserve a better life.
Нормальні, цивілізовані люди, тому що ми вартуємо того.
In a week, the same bus will bring Zina back to Rome. Rebibia is another metro station in Rome and the biggest meeting place of Ukrainian women in Italy. On Thursdays and Sundays, buses from Ukraine arrive here, just as they do at the Piramide station. Here you can find a Ukrainian-Italian non-governmental organization, which allows Ukrainian migrants to buy some Ukrainian food, newspapers and exchange books.
What have you got today? Is this a love story? Sheldon? Have you got anything interesting, any adventure stories?
But first and foremost, people come here looking for work. Rebibia is one huge employment agency. Behind this rope are women who either lost their jobs or just came from Ukraine and are looking for some vacancies. They stand here for hours, waiting for offers. Usually, job offers come from the women who need a substitute while they are on vacation. Italians do not come here. They look for babysitters, cleaners and nurses through intermediaries.
The labor market is overcrowded. There are too many people searching for work. A lot depends on documents. At the moment, I'm still living here illegally.
Romania has been in Rome for half a year. She made up her mind to come here after her divorce. But she has not managed to find a steady job yet. There are only temporary offers. Romania substituted Ukrainian women who had been on vacation. Now, even that kind of job is not an offer. To avoid becoming too depressed, Romania is walking along the tourist routes of Rome. She is trying not to catch the eye of the Italian Carabinieri police. If one of them checks her documents, she will be deported immediately. Romania has little money, but she goes to shops to dream about a future life in Ukraine.
How I wish I had such a cozy home. I wish I would come home, sit on a sofa, hug my child, and relax for a while. The kitchen is also nice. When I finish all the renovation work on my Ukrainian house, I'll invite you for a cup of coffee. We have started a big construction project upstairs. My mother has already changed the floor in one of the rooms.
Romania's home in the town of Horodok, Lviv region, is on the brink of ruin. Her daughter and mother, Yulia and Lyuba, continue to live there despite the risk of collapse.
We have taken out many loans and have to pay them off. That's why Romania went to Italy to earn money. We started renovation works but ran out of money. We are waiting for more money now. Without more money, we can only dream about a better home. Come on, let's do your hair.
Romania sent back home small sums of money, only enough for little presents for Yulia.
We've got a goal in life. We need to renovate our family home.
Almost all the women who work in Italy begin telling their stories in the same way. In the beginning, women go abroad to earn money for refurbishments or to buy a new flat. Their initial motivation is to copy their neighbors, who have improved their standards of living by working abroad. As their children grow, the need for extra finances expands, and mothers find themselves having to stay abroad to provide for their families.
Every mother wants to give her child everything they need, so that they won't feel jealous of other children. Every mother wants their child to have a good education. I didn't come here for my own benefit. I did it for her. She's young now, but when she becomes older, she will see the beautiful homes of her friends. She will want to study at university. If I stayed at home, I wouldn't be able to help her build her future.
Yulia has been going to church each Sunday since she was a little child. Her mother used to go with her. Now her grandmother supports this family tradition. But she worries whether she can play the same role of a close friend in Julia's life as her mother did. Romania's absence is especially painful today because it is Yulia's birthday. She's 11 years old.
How are you doing?
Everything is okay.
What do you feel in your soul? Do you miss your mother?
Very much.
Do you pray for her? Praying makes you stronger. Your mother prays for you, and you pray for your mother. And you unite in that prayer. God is looking at both of you praying and will give you peace of mind. Our Lord is kind. He won't leave you alone. You have a grandmother who supports you. Your relatives are around you. I'm sure that God will help you and everything will be all right. Your mother will come back soon. Don't be upset. Everything will be okay.
It's nice to know that my mother thinks of me and sends me gifts. The clothes she sends me keep me warm, but her love would keep me warmer. It's difficult for them to be there. It's difficult for me to be here. Unfortunately, I have no other option.
Happy birthday to you!
This is the first birthday that Yulia is celebrating without her mother. Her grandmother did her best to make sure Yulia would not be sad. She arranged a party for her granddaughter.
Julia helped me yesterday to prepare for the party. We tidied up and cooked for the birthday. She had been helping out at home for the last 2 days, doing her best to be helpful so that her mother will praise her. This is the first time we celebrate Julia's birthday with her mother. We hope this situation won't last long. Hopefully, Romania will not have to go abroad to work. We hope she will find a well-paid job here.
There are some well-paid jobs here, but all the best jobs are abroad. Nevertheless, some people want to stay in their homeland.
For Romania, her daughter's birthday is the happiest day of the year. She is understandably upset not to be able to congratulate her daughter in person. Romania spends her last euro on a bus journey to take her to a cafe with Wi-Fi, so she can at least wish her daughter a happy birthday. Romania will do her best to put a brave face on the situation and will not tell her daughter that she still hasn't found a job.
My dear daughter, happy birthday. Thank you. You're 11 years old now. That's such a nice number. May the Holy Mother save and preserve you forever. May she be near you, hold you by the hand, and lead you all your life. I'm sorry that I'm far away and I cannot hug and kiss you. You must be strong and patient. Look at this necklace. This is Mitro's present. It's beautiful. And Nazar gave me a handbag. Whoa, it's so elegant. Mom, when will you come back? Julia, darling, I don't know what to say. I love you so much. Okay, Mom, I love you very much. Goodbye. Hello, Marina. Mama is calling. I'll come home in a few days. Are you waiting for me? Will you meet me? I want you to meet me. I'll be there.
Наталя Ващук visits her daughter once a year. Now she is on her way to Ukraine on vacation. She has been taking care of an old senora for 8 years. Each morning, this Ukrainian nurse from Boyerka goes to the market to buy food.
Italians are used to only eating fresh food. Everything should be freshly cooked and eaten at once. As a rule, they have vegetables for supper. Ukrainians do not eat such fresh produce. Italians eat vegetables and live to be 100 years old. Let's go to the market. I'll show you how many different kinds of vegetables are sold here. I've got a friend here. We will buy food from him. He's a nice boy.
Guarda bello, lo facciamo una foto per te.
Tutto bene,
signora? Sì, 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 mi dai. Come, lo prendo un po' di pomodori da te?
Sì.
Sì. Trosche spinato.
Spinach is rich in iron. It's very healthy. We don't need much for 2 people. It's difficult to be without salad when I'm at home, but such things are expensive in Ukraine. Today I did not buy much food. Sometimes I need more. It was very difficult at the beginning, but I got used to this life. For someone as sociable as me, who was used to working as part of a large group, it was difficult to get used to being imprisoned in a house and only being able to go out once a week. But a human being can get used to anything.
Natalia has a day off today, the last one before her vacation. She goes to the city center to buy a present for her daughter.
A questo?
Un euro.
Un euro solo?
Sì.
Vabbè, aspetta. Che pago?
Grande no?
No, grande no.
This is a nice souvenir. I've never seen this one before. The Colosseum.
Roma.
This is for my daughter Marina. She has a collection.
The Ukrainian community is one of the biggest diasporas in Italy. You can find Ukrainian churches even in small Italian towns. Even where there are no Ukrainian churches, Ukrainian Orthodox priests often come to Catholic churches to recite the liturgy in their native language. Each Sunday, there are many Ukrainian women in Italian churches, but there are no men.
В Італії дуже поширена така група, називається «Матері в молитві», так? Це от жінки, які один раз до місяця...
Mothers in Prayer is very popular in Italy. Once a month, women gather together to pray for their children and their families. This movement has spread, and we even preach about it in our sermons. Prayer helps these women support themselves and their relatives.
Ніколи не будуть мати успіху, але самі стараємося підтримати молитвою.
After the liturgy, the women go to the churchyard for a picnic. They bring food with them. This is the time when they can meet their friends, relax after work, and speak their native language.
How are you today? Do you visit the sick in hospital? You are welcome at 10:30 next week. They come to church every Sunday. You know, people often bring information about job vacancies to the church, and we share this information with our congregation. The number of job opportunities is always decreasing. We are living through a kind of crisis. Salaries are much lower and there are fewer vacancies. It will have an impact on Ukraine as well, because Italians are now paying less.
Father Porfiri knows everything about the problems of Ukrainian women who are working here. They not only come to him for confession, but also ask for his advice and share their mental anguish with him. Typically, women are upset not because of the working conditions, but because of the way their families in Ukraine see them. After a few years of separation from their mothers, their children begin to treat them like cash machines.
Sometimes a mother comes home for a few months and her children start to ask her, "Mama, how long do you plan to stay here? We're short of money." This is the most painful thing for any mother. They feel as if their children are sending them off to perform feudal service.
Yes, it looks like a modernized serfdom. At first, when I came to Italy, I lived with one family and was given a tiny room that resembled a closet. It only had cupboards and my bed.
This is the small town of Nadvirna in the Ternopil region, which Tetyana Roshko left 13 years ago for Italy. Her three children stayed with Tetyana's parents after she divorced her husband. He still lives in the house where they used to live as a family.
Не, трохи за пеню трохи.
I had a bad life with my husband. He used to drink a lot and beat me. I'm ashamed to tell you about our family life. I worked as a teacher and I could not even afford to buy a pair of shoes for myself. I needed to feed my children. The state did not support me with my three children. Living and working here in a foreign country, I can provide my children with everything they need. They told me I had a husband and so I should not expect to receive social benefits. But my husband had no job. He had taken everything from the house, even the children's toys. He lives now like a homeless person.
For 3 or 4 years, I cried because my wife was not around. But now I've grown used to it.
When Tetyana moved to Italy, there was no internet in Nadvirna. Tetyana still keeps hundreds of letters written by her children. They are full of stories about school problems, drawings, and hints about the presents they were waiting for.
They even started to write ciao in Italian. They started studying the Italian language so that I could take them to Italy. They used to say, Mama, we have already learned Italian, so now you can take us with you. My youngest daughter, Roxolana, drew a picture of our family, mother, father, and children all together. She wanted us to be like a real family.
Tetyana is horrified by the conditions in which many children are growing up without their migrant parents. As time goes by, the situation is getting worse. For example, in Luncheon, children party all night long, and police have caught several drug dealers. As to the children drinking beer, nobody even cares.
Once my son invited his friends over for a New Year celebration. It was terrible. The boys brought vodka, beer, and wine. I realized then that I could end up losing my children if they stayed in Ukraine.
Today, Tetyana's youngest daughter, Roxolana, Alina, Tetyana's daughter-in-law, and two grandchildren are waiting for Tetyana at home. The grandchildren already have Italian names, Dennis and Manuela. 6 years ago, Tetyana took all her children to Italy.
But for all of us, not in the center of Naples, which is dirty, criminal and crowded. That's why I found a flat in this district, which was safe for children. This is my mother's room, but she does not sleep here because she works day and night. This is where my brother lives with his wife and children. Yes, Dennis? And Emanuela has fallen asleep already. This is my room. My brother painted it pink. Life is difficult. I get up at 5 o'clock in the morning to cook breakfast and make sandwiches for my eldest son, who is going to work. The first years after their arrival was very challenging. You're my obedient boy. Where is your place?
I always felt there had been a distance between me and my children. I can still feel it. Children seem to be happy, but Roxolana is constantly saying, Mama, I want to go back to Ukraine. I want to hear my native language. I can't stay here anymore. I usually answer, what would have become of you if we had stayed in Ukraine?
18-year-old Roxolana works as a nurse, like her mother. And Tatiana's son, Ivan, works in a humanitarian aid depot.
I see my future in Ukraine. I don't want to work for anybody, only for myself. I want to open my own shop back in Ukraine. I'll work here for a few more years and then I plan to go back home. My mother wants to finish repairing the house, and we're helping her with it.
The house in Nadvirna is almost finished.
At the moment, we are remodeling the interior of the house and laying a new floor. We've installed a new heating system.
In a few months, the building should be ready for a housewarming party. But it is unlikely that Tatiana will come back to Ukraine in the near future. She is currently focused on providing a bright future for her grandchildren.
We have not finished our home yet because I had to educate my children first. They are already getting married now, but I have no place to live in. I wish I could go to Ukraine immediately. Some people poke fun at me and say that I have not earned enough money yet. I have earned more than enough, but I want to give a better life to my grandchildren.
Natalia Vaschuk has already bought an apartment in Boyarka, not far from Kyiv. She even renovated it. She has fulfilled all the plans she had 8 years ago. But this progress has come at a considerable cost. During the years Natalia spent in Italy, her daughter Marina grew up. She is 15 now, and over the years she has become more and more distant from her mother.
She's just like all teenagers. They can be awkward to talk to. The distance between us is the real problem. I call her every day. One day she's talkative, but the next day she's not. I'm sure this will pass. She was always a little bit reserved. I always used to be reserved at her age. I also used to be reserved at her age, but things changed with time.
Today, Marina's godmother took her to the airport. Marina will see her mother today.
Your mom is flying home. She'll be here soon.
Natalia Vaschuk will spend 1 month in Ukraine. She hopes she will be able to improve her relationship with her daughter. But she is not planning to stay at home forever.
I will not stay in Ukraine for now. I want to work some more. And I'd like to educate my child. If I were with her in Ukraine, I could take care of her. But I would have to work night and day to earn enough for a decent life, not half a day like I work in Italy.
Красивый?
Да.
Скажи спасибо.
Спасибо.
Мамочка.
This vase is hand-painted. This one is hand-painted too. This figure is also handmade. It was supposed to be painted too.
Diana has also grown up without her mother. Her grandmother has been bringing her up since she was a child. They live in the village of Loyeva in Ivano-Frankivsk region. They have a fully renovated house, nice furniture, and many souvenirs from abroad. In order to create a mini Italy in her village, Diana's mom has been working abroad for 12 years.
I put on this dress for church today. I tried to pretend I didn't notice that people were staring at me. People noticed that I am better dressed than they are.
Diana stands out among the children of the village. She is the only one with a quadricycle for riding in the mountains and an expensive camera. Buying gifts for her daughter has helped Diana's mother maintain her connection to her child.
My grandmother explained to me that my mother had to leave us in order to buy some toys for me. I have always known that my mama works to be able to buy me things. When she first came home from Italy to visit, I was scared. I was too shy to talk to her. I wanted to hug her, but I didn't know how to approach her. I was afraid to say or do something wrong. I would ask my grandmother for permission to do something, and only then ask my mother. She was a stranger for me. I did not know her. How can you form a bond with a child? My mother started by buying me presents like Barbie dolls. Gradually, I became more attached to her and started calling her mama. And she started calling me more often. She took an interest in my life, and we became close.
Diana says she is used to receiving presents all the time, not only on birthdays and special occasions. Many of the children of migrant workers have a similar experience.
Mama sends us money and parcels each month. A week after we receive a parcel, Ruslan asks, when will you send us something else? She usually answers, you don't need your mother anymore, you only need presents. Ruslan replies, no, I need both you and presents. His mother is trying her hardest to improve his life, but she cannot be with him. I know that absentee parents send money to their children. In many cases, the children do not listen to their parents anymore.
I understand that we would have nothing if she didn't work abroad.
Helena says that she will work in Italy for as long as she's able to. She wants to buy Ruslan an apartment and give him a decent education.
I got used to life. I got used to living without my mom. I talked to her via Skype. That's enough for me.
In a year or two, Ruslan will be more independent. Who knows, maybe he will be reluctant to do what his grandma says. I can't change anything now. We'll see. Maybe it will be necessary to bring him here.
Meanwhile, Helena is packing her suitcase. Tomorrow morning, she is taking the bus back to Ukraine. At last, she will be able to hug her son, and in 20 days, she will return to Italy.
I wish he could finish school and study at university. I hope he will be more successful and happier than I am.
Ruslan is focused on the coming days. He's looking forward to swimming in the river with his mother. Tetyana Roshko's ex-husband from Nadvirna hopes that their family will be reunited soon, or at least he will be invited to Italy. But nobody is waiting for him there.
If she says, come and join us, I would go without any doubt. But she's not said that so far.
You might think that our family is beautiful, we're all together and we enjoy ourselves. I agree that everything looks nice and the grandchildren bring us happiness, but even getting this far has involved a huge effort.
Many of the Ukrainian women working abroad to earn money for their children find it difficult to stop, even if their kids ask them to give up their jobs.
I think our mother should take care of herself and give up her job.
She's
been toiling night and day for many years. And she's long overdue a rest. She could have her own little garden where she could work instead. She loves flowers.
Each of the women who went to Italy to earn money would tell you that she had no other choice. This is true for each of the women featured in this documentary. Faced with the choice of staying in Ukraine and starving, or going abroad to make a living, they chose the latter. Short-term objectives become an everyday routine, and they soon find themselves unable to go home. Many leave for a year and end up staying for over a decade. They become cash machines for their families, for as long as they can manage.
I'm ashamed of Ukraine because I used to work as a school teacher there for 12 years. Ukraine is our Ukraine. The people who live there created the country and it reflects them. If the people themselves were different, Ukraine would be completely different. Ukraine can be a strong nation and then would not have to leave our homes and go abroad to earn money. I wish I could have lived a different life.
Ну, да, не йде, не до. Йде. Йдемо.